Psychiatry at Columbia University. His neurophysiological theory exploring the effects of yoga breathing in treating anxiety, depression, PTSD and stress-related medical conditions has been validated in hundreds of clinical trials. And he's here today to teach us how to use breath practices to enhance social engagement, empathy and cooperation. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richard Brown.
So we're going to have a whirlwind tour through the science behind this, and then hopefully a little bit of time for practice. So if you have questions, you may want to write them down for later.
Speak louder, please.
Okay. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So if you have questions, I'd write them down. This will be a whirlwind tour. I'm going to ask Hazel to work on the slides with me. Sure. Okay, so here's the doctor saying to the patient, you've been fooling around with alternative things like breathing, meditation, herbs. And you notice how the doctor looks. He looks like a cadaver, right? Okay. So I hope if you do some breathing, you will experience looking like the patient. Next slide. So autonomic balance, balance of the autonomic nervous system protects against the negative effects of stress on the mind and body. Autonomic balance is the key for emotion regulation, social-emotional learning, ability to cooperate, empathy, academic performance, and I would say also a sense of fairness as well. Next slide. So you have two branches of the autonomic system. The sympathetic branch, when I talk to patients, I call it the stress response system. That helps you deal with all kinds of stress. And it has a pleasure-pain component to it. In other words, there's a part of your stress response system that helps you get the stuff that makes you feel good, right? Sex, drugs, rock and roll. You all look like the rock and roll types. Okay. And there's also an inhibition part that helps you avoid the stuff that will hurt you or kill you, okay? It is counterbalanced by the parasympathetic nervous system, which when I was in medical school in the early 70s, was said to help you regulate all the organs and glands in here, the heart, digestion, etc. But actually, a major, major part of its function is regulating emotions and cooperative interactions with others, as well as solving more complex problems creatively. So the summation of the activity of those two systems results in how you see the world, the emotions and thoughts you have, and what your behavior is like. And for the most part, people operate with a stress response system on overdrive, and the parasympathetic soothing bonding system hardly working at all. Okay, next slide. So we thought years ago most of the vagus nerve, which is 80% of the parasympathetic system, that we thought most of it was dealing with the organs here. That's 20% of it. 80% of it is information from your guts, from inside your body to your brain that totally changes how you work. Okay? And that's a very different idea. In other words, your body is experiencing all kinds of things that is not in your conscious awareness. Next slide. So this is a simple wiring diagram. Okay? Here's kind of the brain messages through the vagus affecting the heart, the lungs, the digestion, the organs, the glands. But the inputs from the body, the 80%, goes to crucial areas. It goes to the frontal cortex so you can solve more difficult problems. It goes through your limbic system so you can organize your emotional states much better. And through the thalamus, it regulates how your brain organizes its perception of the world. Okay? Next slide. So basically, regulating your breathing is the beginning of the road to training your autonomic system to work in an optimal way. So that for most people, their sympathetic system, their stress response system, is way outbalancing the bonding healing system, which also reduces inflammation in the body and delays aging. Okay. Anyone not want to live longer? I just want to make sure. So when you do the proper breathing, and this was described 3,000 years ago in a Chinese medical text, both systems are balanced and optimal, a state they are rarely in. And that's really important. Next slide. There's a lot of other research on that we could go into, but because of time, I'm going to skip into what does this mean for how we relate to each other. So emotional self-regulation develops from parent-child co-regulation. Social engagement and social bonding leads to a co-regulation. And in mammals, the regulators of physiology are embedded in our relationships. It starts in the first phase with face-to-face contact, eye-to-eye contact, which is being lost, okay, progressively. And then phase two is physical contact while being still, or what some scientists call immobilizing without fear. To do that requires trust, safety, and love. So there's a whole sequence here that's important. And these are, if you want to read more about this, Stephen Porges' latest book is amazing. Next slide. So here you have the mother panda with the baby panda. They're making the eye-to-eye contact. They're beginning this sequence. And you can see the mommy koala with the baby koala. They're immobilized and totally co-regulating each other. Okay? Next slide. But the problem is trauma or stress, because stress, we can have stress without severe trauma. It's on a continuum. That disrupts our ability to connect. And it leads to defensive reactions and a distortion of perception of other people and ourselves. And it can lead to immobilization with fear. So that's what we usually call dissociation. And it interferes with that reciprocal co-regulation that's so good for our health, mental and physical. And the problem is, if you've had significant trauma, you cannot feel safe or establish a really trusting relationship, and you have difficulties being close, and you cannot self-soothe. So normally it starts with the mother teaching immobilization without fear, and self-soothing develops as part of that. Next slide. Here are some animals that have been stressed. Okay, you can decide which you look like when you're stressed. I kind of like the bird on the right. The bird is really fierce. Okay? But I don't think you want to meet the gorilla or the panda. Next slide. So we kind of have three states we can be in. On the left side, you have a green state. That's the safety zone. Your parasympathetic is engaged fully. You are using the myelinated vagal nerves. That's 3% of your vagus. It's what distinguishes us from all the other mammals. It's not just what's going on in the cortex. You're less defensive. Your heart rate variability is more like a baby. You can cooperate, be intimate. You can joke, okay? Things you can't do under stress, right? You can immobilize without fear. Then you have the danger zone. Then your sympathetic or stress response system turns on. Poor heart rate variability, defensive, not very cooperative, hypervigilant, overreactive, emotion dysregulation, from underreactive to angry reactive. Under severe life threat, how many people have been in a situation of severe life threat where you felt you were going to be killed? What happens to your breathing? It stops for long periods. It stops, okay? And what's happening is the vagus, the unmyelinated vagus that regulates everything below your diaphragm, is strongly turned on, and you have defensiveness, decreased engagement, immobilization with fear, and that leads into voodoo death. I won't go in, unless you're a cardiologist, I won't get into that. Next slide. So, studies we've done, and we don't have time to go into details on them all, but just to give you severe treatment-resistant generalized anxiety disorder with comorbid conditions, including depression, PTSD, OCD, and other things. Inflammatory bowel disease, the fourth most expensive disease in the U.S., Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. It's the fourth most expensive disease, and the treatments are awful. Southeast Asia tsunami survivors. We've worked with many 9/11 responders. Mississippi healthcare providers, 30 years completely 100% disabled Australian Vietnam veterans with PTSD. South Sudan is a country where everyone has PTSD. Everyone has had 5 to 15 relatives killed in front of them, and that is often minor compared to the general level of trauma. We'll talk about that. A little bit on some studies we're doing with Chris Treater in Boston, and patients with severe symptoms of schizophrenia. Next slide. So the 2004 tsunami hit Indonesia severely, but it also hit a part of India. And you see some of the boats washed ashore. Next slide. With a colleague in Miami, Teresa DeSillo, she went there and worked with colleagues who I'm friends with who do yoga breathing in India, who are scientists at their equivalent of NIH. We had 183 subjects in 5 refugee camps, and one group was just a waitlist control group. They waited 6 weeks to get the breathing intervention. One group got an 8-hour breathing intervention over 4 days, so 2 hours a day for 4 days. And this is 9 months after the tsunami. And another group got the breathing intervention with cognitive behavior therapy with exposure, a particular kind called traumatic incident reduction. And basically, when traumatologists who are supposed experts saw the level of trauma we had in these people, they said they will be ill the rest of their lives. Okay, so let's see what happened. This is a PTSD scoring scale. And the green line are the waitlist people. They didn't change over 6 weeks. And by the way, conditions are horrible at this place. I won't get into it. You can see they're severely ill on this scale. After those 4 days, the group has dropped into remission. Below 30 is remission from PTSD. And the breathing group alone got there without the cognitive behavior therapy, which is very time intensive and expensive. But the red line is a group who got the cognitive behavior therapy and the breathing, and they're kind of about the same as the breathing group. Now, this is a simple PTSD. It's a one-time severe acute trauma. These people lost their children. They lost their husbands. The water, the salt water, washed 200 miles inland, so people were in a state of famine for months because you couldn't grow anything. But in 4 days, on average, they are better. Unheard of. Next slide is their depression scores. So how high is the average New Yorker on this scale? Where should I put my hand? Around here. That's the average New Yorker. So you can see in 4 days, they're down to virtually no depression. Depression's easier to deal with than post-traumatic stress disorder. Next slide. Worked a lot with 9/11 responders for years. No one was here in the US, including New York, was interested in what we were doing. It took a group from Toronto to come and at least do some open series with us. These patients were all responders or 9/11 residents with severe trauma. Are embedded in courses of other large groups of people with trauma, particularly women with sexual trauma, chronic sexual trauma. Next slide. So these are severely ill people. Oh, this is about 8 or 9 years, this group, 8 or 9 years after 9/11. And these people have all been through the best treatment at the best medical centers in New York and are severely symptomatic. They are totally unchanged by standard treatment. The best therapy and medication. So we had 17 in this group. They're again in a much larger group of over 100 subjects with PTSD. They are dramatically different in 2 days. They're smiling for the first time often for 9 years. Next line. There's another group of 27, especially like the worst hit police that I worked with were detectives on body bag detail. Okay. Dealing with that is extremely traumatizing. They are dramatically better. They're not 100% better, but they're dramatically better. Next line. This is, and some people say, well, it's just you, Dr. Brown. No, this is one of our many teachers. She is a yoga therapist and had learned to do breathing therapy one-on-one, but she had been working in Rwanda with victims of the genocide there, and she wanted to know how to work with large groups like I do. And so before she flew to Haiti, several days after the earthquake, I did a 2-hour tutorial over the phone for her, and she's very smart. And this is her, these are about 50 women and children. She's using a church bell to time their breathing. It's a voluntary regulated breathing practice we call coherent breathing. She went back a month later. Those 50 women had been meeting and bringing their friends. They had been meeting every week doing the breathing together. And so the group had almost doubled by the time she came back in a month. Next slide. Now, this is Gretchen working with children. If you hit the left side clip, I think we'll get a little video. This is a Qigong movement with breathing. The children haven't slept for a week. The adults haven't slept for a week. Okay, next slide. This is South Sudan. I've been there a number of times with a philanthropist who's also a radio TV journalist, Ellen Ratner, who funds a clinic on the border with North Sudan. And this is the first time I was there in 2011. This is part of a group of 400 slaves, one of several large groups I've worked with that week, as well as working with women that Ellen had trained, who had, those 19 women who we'll see a picture of had been in slaves in North Sudan for 10 to 20 years. I won't go into what their trauma is like because it's extraordinarily severe. But these people have been in slavery for years. They've been bought out of slavery by a Christian nonprofit. It costs $100,000 worth of hoof and mouth vaccine for one woman. And they've walked barefoot, vaccine, $100,000 worth of vaccine to buy one woman out of slavery. And they walked a week in the sub-Saharan desert and scrub to get across the border. And the translator has just told them that the white boy is going to teach you breathing. And they've hardly eaten or had water for a week. And it's about 110 degrees, and everywhere we are, we're on anthills, okay? So they're not happy. Next slide. So this is another part of another group of 200 on another day. And if you click on that one, we'll play just a couple minutes of that. Ooh, go there. You have to go back to the, to hit that slide. Ooh. Okay, maybe go back one more. Yeah, let's try that one. Somehow you got the last one to play. This should play. Oh, okay. Let's go back one moment to that. I guess we're not going to be able to play it. So basically, the head of the nonprofit that was buying these people out of slavery is very, very, very muscular Christian. And I've taught a lot in the South. I grew up part of the time in the South. And part of my family's from the South. And in parts of the South, they feel that things that come from people in India or China from the pagans, like breathing and meditation, will open you up so the devil will come in. And so he was very reluctant to let me do anything, but since the philanthropist donates money, he gave me 20 minutes. And basically, if we could play the video, there's a dramatic change from beginning to end. And they are laughing and hugging each other. And they then taught me how to sing "It's Spring When the Antelopes Come In," okay? in the Dinka language. Okay? So singing is also a part of this social engagement, and breathing is also a part of singing. But that group cooperation is very important for our co-regulation. Next slide. So last October, a year ago, with my wife and a number of our teachers who assist us, we were in Berlin working with Middle Eastern refugees as well as Kosovo refugees. So Germany has absorbed successive waves of refugees. And here I am working with some children, and kind of impromptu, actually. They wanted to do stuff with me. And we're doing that same movement you saw Gretchen doing with the children in Haiti, doing it with synchronized breathing and really clearing the energy in this part of the body. Next slide. And this is my wife working with a translator. These children have been highly traumatized. The adults have been highly traumatized to get there. And many of the children, it's very hard to sleep, and there's often hundreds of them packed in a gymnasium with barely any living space. And this little girl has what one of the things, and the little boy next to her, have a breathing buddy. She's got a breathing buddy, which is a stuffed animal on her belly. And we teach them the breathing by having them lie down, putting the breathing buddy on, and say, as you breathe in, give your breathing buddy a ride up. And as you breathe out, give your breathing buddy a ride down. Because when people are stressed, their breathing is very dysregulated and staccato, and it's particularly marked in children who are traumatized. And so she's been doing the breathing, and she's much better. The little boy is very bright. He actually could speak some English. And he had hardly been sleeping for weeks, according to his mother, and he was getting into all kinds of trouble, which is understandable. And he's just done the breathing, and then he asked my wife to give him a guided meditation she was using. And he floated to where he came from in Afghanistan in the mountains on a white fluffy cloud. And then he went to sleep. Oh. And he was so asleep, his mother could not wake him up for half an hour, no matter what she did. Next slide. And we have an ongoing community project in Chemung County, which is in kind of the western part of New York State between Corning and Binghamton. Mm-hmm. We have some retired school teachers and mental health administrators, and the Commissioner of Mental Health is very behind it. We're bringing it to the children and the whole community. There's a lot of violence in the schools. There are 30 ethnic immigrant groups. It's kind of Rust Belt post-manufacturing. And this is one of the girls, little girls doing the breathing in the after-school community center. You see the little doggy breathing buddy on her belly. And the kids love it, and they love the breathing, and they love the relaxation. And they try to sneak in for extra sessions if they can. And we just, for the first time after years of trying hard, we just started introducing it to two New York City public schools, not high schools. One high school, one grade school. Next slide. And the Native American community, I have Native American ancestors, is the most stressed in America, the most depressed and stressed, and the most horrible health outcomes. And this is one of our teachers working with Sioux children in North Dakota. Next slide. And this is an example. I could give you many examples, but she's become a friend. And I've been with her in South Sudan. Chalene, and she gave us permission to use her name, was this one of the first two women certified to fly the U-2's flight plane. That's the hardest plane in the world to fly. And after she retired from the Air Force, she was flying for United Airlines. And she was supposed to be the pilot on flight 93 on September 11, 2001. Her connecting flight delayed her, and a close friend of hers from the Air Force Academy went down with the plane, and she had severe survivor guilt. She has had a lot of combat training and experience to be a U-2 pilot, and she was sure had she been flying the plane, she would have shot with terrorists.
Yeah.
And she grew up in New Mexico hunting from the time she was about 8, so maybe, but I don't think so. At any rate, she became severely PTSD with disconnection from everyone and everything she'd ever believed in. And she tried to, she was like living in a void, a hollow void, and she was trying to reconnect to life. So she did 3 tours in Iraq as an embedded journalist. I could have told her not to do that, but she then did 2 years of post-Katrina relief work in Mississippi, and she was not changed. And she decided if she became a doctor, she would find meaning in life again. So at age 40, she enrolled in Columbia's pre-med post-bac program. And again, I would have said to her, that's not exactly the best thing to do. But she did, and in 2 weeks she realized she was going to flunk out because she couldn't absorb anything. And she's a brilliant person with an amazing nervous system. And a friend of hers told her to do my breathing course, and she came. And the afternoon of the first day, she then came to my wife, next slide, And this is what she said. The breathing and the rhythm of the bells were like the tide in the Arabian Gulf. The sound of the tide and the feel of the waves rolling over me were the only things that made me feel connected to life. The breathing was that and much more powerful because I was physically and mentally connecting to a larger energy source. Next slide. I found myself weeping when Dr. Brown said, "Think of those you love." I came away with a sense of being reunited with my life and loved ones. For the first time in years, I wanted to be connected to something besides a war or disaster zone. After the breathing, during the meditation, I felt connected to the universe and everyone in it. She finished with high honors. She then finished first in her class in medical school at another medical school. And she's in her residency, and she's helped me with some of the work in South Sudan, actually. I think she may go into tropical medicine, GYM, ultimately. Next slide. So this is the best we can be. And the question is, what's the easiest way to relieve people of stress and bring them there? And breathing is cheap. It's easy, you can do it anytime, anywhere. It's kind of the quickest thing. Are there other ways to work on these systems? Yes, there are. But the breathing is the easiest thing, and it has great health benefits long term. Let's see, next slide. So if you're more interested, you can look at some of these things, and I co-teach with a number of other amazing teachers. And we just came out with American Psychiatric Association-sponsored textbook, which is the first of complementary and integrated treatments in psychiatric practice. That's the top one highlighted. And our website, you can email my wife and I at breath-body-mind.com. Next one. Let's see. I think that might be. Oh, if you want some more reading on all this, there's a bunch of stuff. Okay. So let's do a little practice so you can experience a little bit what I'm talking about. So one interesting way to get some stress out is by tapping on the body and moving with it. I think this part, I'm going to stand on a chair so you can see me. I'm going to ask you all to stand up. And just, this is like a giant adult Simon said. Pretend you're 5 years old and you have the amazing imagination of a 5-year-old. Okay. And tapping your right side, moving your body. Remember you're 5. You don't care what anybody thinks about how you look. your eyes. Observe the change inside. Observe the sensations in the body. Observe the kind of thoughts you're having, the quality of your attention, and the rhythm of your breath. Okay. Now we'll do a little bit of movement with coherent breathing. I'm going to pace you with my voice. Let's stand up. And again, just imitate what I'm going to do. This is a movement because of the space we're in from Qigong called painting the waterfall. So breathing in. Breathing out. Breath in. Two. Three. Four. Breath out. Breath in. Two. Three. Four. Breath out. Two. Three. Four. Breath in. Breath out. Breath in. Breath out, smooth and fluid. Breath in. Now, if you can, arms up here. Maybe feet a little wider than shoulder width. I can't do it in this chair, but if you can. Yeah, you may have to kind of angle yourselves, okay? Breathing in. Collect sky energy. Sun and stars. Breathing out. With a flat back hinge from the hips, send that sky energy into the earth. Breathing in. Earth energy between your hands, coming up, breathing in, and send it out to the heavens. Breathing in. Breathing in, you're doing great. Breathing in. So there's a verse in the Tao Te Ching about breathing, and it starts out, breathing out. It starts out by saying the purpose of the breathing practices, breathing in now, is to induce the tenderness of a newborn baby. And we can measure that. It's been measured in numerous labs now. You're getting a dramatic turning back of the aging clock. Breathing in. One more. Breathing out, just relax, close your eyes, observe the sensation. Start with your hands. What do you feel in your hands? You may feel a buzzing and tingling sensation, because this breathing opens up the smallest blood vessels. Okay, opening your eyes. So let's sit down. Now we're going to do some breathing with a bell. To pace you, a chime to pace you. You're going to hear a high tone and a low tone. And I'm going to ask you to breathe in on the high tone and out on the low tone. Okay. And I'll guide you. I recommend, if possible, closing your eyes. Now, people with severe trauma may not be able to close their eyes all the way. Many may not be able to close their eyes for weeks or months. It's okay. If you don't feel comfortable closing your eyes all the way, close in part way. Go inside to feel what's happening and just follow my directions. There's a low tone. There's a high tone. Can you hear those two tones in the back? If anyone can't hear it, raise your hand. Breathing in on the high tone. Out on the low tone. first, like it's hard to go the length of a chime in or out. You can pause your breath for a second or two, that's fine. Breath in, the belly gently expands. Breath out, the belly gently contracts. Out on the low breath, the low tone.
Just let your breath go in whatever rhythm it wants to be. Observing the changes in your body, in your mind, in your spirit. And when you're ready, you can open your eyes. Questions or experiences? We only had a short time. Love to have you all for a day or two.
Yes, I'm wondering how you work with kids.
The breathing rate to get a coherent resonance in mind, body, spirit has to shift depending on size. So for adults, say 6 feet taller, we were breathing at 5 breaths per minute. For someone 6 feet and higher, I get a lot of, when I work in the military, a lot of 6'5", 6'6", 6'8", people. They ideally start here, but they quickly, in a few weeks, go down to 3 breaths per minute. For smaller children, like the children you saw Gretchen working with in Haiti, their mothers were breathing in on one chime and out the next chime. But for the small kids, they were breathing in and out on one chime, which they easily do, there's no problem. That puts them in their coherent resonant state of their nervous system and their electrical energy field. With autistic children, there are some yoga therapists who know how to work with autistic children. It's very intense and time-consuming. So at the moment, I'm working on societies, whole societies. So we're working on a whole countrywide intervention in South Sudan. And, you know, but anyway, so you can do this with children. You can do it with autistic children. It's important to go slowly. You don't want to shift people, whether it's an autistic child or someone with PTSD, too quickly, because that itself can be a shock. So this is a very gradual, subtle way of healing. Okay. Other question? The question is, when do you do this? What's the best time of day? Anytime you can do it. See, the other thing, I've taught and learned many sophisticated kinds of breathing that if I did them in an airport, I'd get arrested. Because I look so weird, right? This you can do anytime, anywhere, and no one has to know you're doing it. And I'd say it just depends. It looks like from the data that if you do, how long did we breathe for?
5 minutes.
Any other guesses?
7 minutes.
7 minutes. Yeah, you breathe for about 7.5 minutes with the chimes. By that time, most everybody. Your whole cortex is in a synchronous high amplitude alpha rhythm, which is what advanced yogis are in when they've been practicing meditation and breathing for many years. Okay, and in fact, one of the early studies of this was with Zen monks in Japan at 3 famous monasteries. Researchers from the US joined some researchers in Japan, and the abbots rated the monks as advanced or not advanced. All the advanced monks, by chance, had been meditating for 20 plus years for 6 or 8 hours a day. And what they found when they measured the breathing, among many things they measured in the monks, the ones who were advanced immediately began doing this breathing. They'd never been taught it. It took years of meditation for their bodies to discover it intuitively. And if you ask them, do you know what you're doing with your breathing? They say, I have no idea. So my feeling is, unless you want to spend the next 20 years meditating for 8 hours a day, do the breathing to train your mind to be in that state, and it begins to carry over to when you're not doing the breathing. But you got to practice. You can slip in and out of it doing most things when you've practiced a while. In terms of, is there a YouTube video? No. For a variety of reasons, we don't put stuff up. You might find it. The best thing would be to come to a course. There are a number of people teaching this. I'm not the only one. A number of people have discovered it. And two modern labs, one in Italy, one in the US, not knowing any of this ancient stuff, making people breathe in all possible rhythms, discovered everything they could measure became optimal for hours after doing a round of this breathing, including hormones and other stuff.
What is this type of breathing? Exactly.
We're calling it coherent breathing, but some researchers in the scientific literature refer to it as resonant breathing. because it sets up a coherence and resonance with your mind, with your heart. How often are your mind and heart together? Hardly ever.
Hardly.
Guaranteed.
Right.
Okay. When you do this, your head and heart come together in remarkable, measurable ways.
I did the TM training, transcendental meditation.
Yes.
I do meditate, not every day, but often. Perhaps I could incorporate this breathing with that.
Yeah, you can do it while you do your TM.
Yeah.
Yeah. It can be incorporated with many, many, many things. Is there another location? I do lectures all the time. So if you go to our website, which is breath-body-mind.com, you'll see you click on courses and lectures, and you'll see things coming up. I have a couple things coming up this in November and December in this area. So there are many, many possibilities as well. And one of my teachers, because I train a lot of teachers, one is Irina, who's an amazing yoga teacher who's also knows how to teach the breathing very well.
I give training